Supreme Court denied the Attorney General's request for further appeal. What that means is the case was then sent back to me. I had 10 days this is the county in which he was tried. I had 10 days to make a decision to either retry Mr. Irons or to dismiss the charges. Yesterday afternoon, the Honorable Judge Deborah Lessy signed the order and memorandum of dismissal with prejudice, meaning the charges can never be refiled. And she also ordered Mr. Irons' immediate release. It's my understanding that he was released yesterday, just hours after the judgment was signed. That's the procedural history. Just want to dive in a little bit. I'm sure you guys may have some questions to tell you what the basis of our decision was. So when we knew that the Cole County Circuit Court had set aside the conviction, we knew there was some time that the appellate rights would attach, and so we'd have some time on our end with our investigators to do our own independent investigation. We did that. My investigator to my right, Mike Harvey, led that investigation, interviewed every living witness that was available, willing to testify, I should say. We reviewed the entire trial transcripts, and we came to the conclusion that there were certain errors in the trial and certain things that if we were to retry him again, it would be nearly impossible to do so and uphold our own ethical standards. I'll highlight three areas of concern for us. The first was testimony in the trial about fingerprints. The evidence at the scene showed that there were two fingerprints on a glass storm door at the residence. There were two different reports on those fingerprints. The first report indicated that the one fingerprint belonged to the victim and the other fingerprint was unidentifiable. The second report took it a step further and not only said it was a victim's fingerprint and an unidentifiable person's fingerprint, but it also excluded Mr. Irons. That second report, for reasons unknown to us, was never disclosed to the defense. That severely impacted the defense's right to a fair trial and certainly a right to put forth the position that someone else could have committed this crime. The biggest issue for us, I think, was the interview that was conducted of Mr. Irons. The detective who conducted that interview is now deceased, so we were not able to speak with him, of course. The problem that we saw was this. The interview was conducted one-on-one, detective and Mr. Irons, behind a closed door, no recording devices, nothing in writing, no written waiver of Miranda rights, no third-party witness to confirm whether Miranda was given. That is our view of that interview technique, as well as how it played out in the trial. That is a textbook reason why you don't do an interview that's not recorded. That protects not only the suspect, but it also protects the police. So that was a huge problem for us. So now, again, faced with the proposition of having to retry him based upon a confession, an alleged confession, where the person who obtained that confession allegedly is now deceased, would have been a virtual impossibility. The third big piece for us was the identification of Mr. Irons. The entire trial was based upon circumstantial evidence and in addition to the alleged confession. There were several witnesses who placed Mr. Irons near the scene of the crime. Nobody placed him at the scene of the crime. There was one witness who allegedly told police officers that Mr. Irons admitted to burglarizing the home and shooting the victim. That witness is still alive. Our investigator tried to reach out to him, and he refused to cooperate and basically recanted his story. So you put all those things together, and we were faced with a relatively easy decision, which is we have a high ethical standard to not charge somebody with a crime or try somebody for a crime unless we know we can prove that person's guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. We certainly do not believe that we could prove his guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. So